I've talked before about different frameworks that you can use to automate activities in the browser, for instance, to construct test fixtures for web apps. But most of these have a drawback. They require some kind of close integration with a browser, typically through a plugin. PyDoll, the Python framework I'm talking about today, works differently. It only works with the Chromium family browsers, Google Chrome and Microsoft Edge mostly, but it uses the Chrome DevTools protocol, a native part of Chrome, to connect directly to the Chrome runtime and interact with it. No plugins, just your code. So let's take a close look at how PyDoll works. In this sample PyDoll script, I'm opening an instance of Edge on Microsoft Windows, navigating to a locally hosted website, and performing some basic interactions. So I'm basically using it for testing a locally developed web app. PyDoll uses a very high-level object-oriented interface to the browser and all the components on a web page. These commands here set up a group of options for the browser we're going to open, and the with context block lets us fire up an instance of the browser, do work with it, and then clean up its resources automatically when we're finished. Incidentally, I'm running in incognito mode as a way to ensure no cached data or user info interferes with our work. Each of the commands we're issuing to the browser are pretty straightforward to follow. For instance, when I start the browser, I get back an object that represents the first tab in the browser. I can then use that tab to navigate to a URL, look for an object on it by way of its ID, in this case it's a text field, and insert text into it or issue keystrokes to it. I can then look for a button, again by ID, or I could look via some other criteria like a class or a component type, and send a click to it. I can also watch for specific browser events, such as when a page is loaded. And that's done by first enabling event listening, and then attaching an onEvent listener, much like you would in JavaScript, actually. What this does is wait for a page to load after we click something, and then run a predefined callback function. And that function takes a screenshot of the tab. This is another nice built-in feature with PyDoll, and it writes that to a file in our current working directory. So if I run this code, you'll see a browser window open, and then after a short delay, it will navigate to the page that I specified, perform the interaction, take a screenshot of the tab after the interaction, and then close the browser. And if we look in the project directory, we now have a new screenshot of the tab after the interaction took place. PyDoll is also, as you can see from the generous use of async, async first. That means it's easier to write concurrent automation. For instance, it's easy to automate something that's performed in a dozen tabs at once, side by side. The downside, of course, is that you need to be familiar with the async way of doing things in Python, including how to make synchronous behaviors play nicely with asynchronous code. For instance, I'm sure there's a more elegant way to handle waiting for the page to finish loading and then snapping the screen without the use of this sleep function and the few other things I defined here, but this is the easy, if crude, way to accomplish that. Another thing PyDoll lets us do, thanks to Chrome DevTools protocol, is run in headless mode. If I enable this option and rerun our script, you'll notice we don't see a browser instance pop up, although you can see the logging messages I enabled that give us some idea of what's going on in the background. Headless mode is really useful if we're doing lots of automated testing and we want all of it to run in the background and not interfere with whatever's happening on the desktop. The single biggest drawback with using PyDoll is, again, it's limited to working with Chrome and its cousins. If you want to work with more browsers, the Playwright library, which I've covered before, is the better choice. But PyDoll's simplicity is a big draw, and it's theoretically possible we could have a future version of PyDoll that worked with Firefox's own similar built-in automation tooling. That's it for this episode. If you liked it, leave a comment below, and don't forget to follow Dev with Serdar and InfoWorld on Facebook, YouTube, and InfoWorld.com.